Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your heart, and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God. For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Return with me to our screen as we sing our first song this morning, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold.
Please rise and bow with me. Dear most blessed Heavenly Father, what joy there is to come before the one and only God of the universe. Though we don't always find the road we travel, the easy road to take, we come to find that you are on that road beside us. Though we think that at our journey's end we'll find a road more easy, we often discover that after one accomplishment, you give us harder roads to take. When we've finished one task and thought we've earned a deserved rest, we discover that that was just the preparation to make us more ready for the next. What a wonderful joy it is to be useful to your purpose and to the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though you, through you, we find eternal salvation and a kingdom of love and compassion. You call us here in service for such a short time. Help us to understand the tremendous responsibility you have placed within our hands. Give us the strength and the courage to carry out all you ask of us. 2,000 years ago, Jesus came to bring us life everlasting. his life here on this earth was not easy. And when he finished his work here, his mission didn't end here either, as he sits today upon your right side in the constant prayer for us while building and preparing a beautiful and wonderful place so that we may be with him and with you for all eternity. So please help us to carry out our mission here, to prepare and build the church for his return. For it's in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. As we go back to our screen again for our responsive reading. Thou hast dwelt well with thy servant, O Lord, according unto thy word.
Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I have believed thy commands.
Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now have I kept my word. Amen. And bless the reading of God's word. Our praise hymn this morning, we have two of them. We Three Kings. We have another song from the Kids' Corner.
monkeys in the jungle say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. The monkeys in the jungle say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. The monkeys in the jungle say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Thank you, Lord, for making me. Oh, let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for making me.
The bears in the woods say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
The bears in the woods say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
The bears in the woods say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for making me.
Oh, let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Let everything that God made say thank you, Lord.
The gators in the swamp say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Chomp, chomp, chomp.
The gators in the swamp say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Chomp, chomp, chomp.
The gators in the swamp say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Chomp, chomp, chomp.
Thank you, Lord, for making me.
Oh, let everything that God made say thank you, Lord. Let everything that God made.
Right. I saw everybody doing the chomp, 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 and good for you guys. So our memory verse this morning from Isaiah. This is the last week that we'll be doing the Isaiah 56:3, because next month we'll have a new verse. But all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him, that's Jesus Christ, the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah 53:6.
All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah 53:6.
Amen. Good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
If you notice, my voice is a little bit different. I started to come down with a cold in the middle of the night, so we'll just have to pray that I make it all the way through the sermon this morning. But I want to wish all of you a happy new year coming this week, and we thank all of you for being here this morning on a dreary, drizzly, rainy day, and all of you that are watching us, and we want to make sure for all of those people that are watching us tonight on television that if you want to see a really wonderful, wonderful Christmas Eve program, turn to us at 8 o'clock on Wednesday morning. As they're going to instead of rebroadcasting this service, they'll broadcast for the first time our Christmas Eve service, and so you should have a great, because we had a house full of kids. It truly was a blessing to be here and see all the kids and have just the wonderful time that we had of Christmas Eve in the most magnificent birthday party ever for celebrating the birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that you continue to know at home, we're still doing counseling here. If you have problems, if you're having difficulty with marriage, alcohol, drugs, any of the multitude of things, especially if you're depressed and going through a bad time here through the holidays, we ask you to give us a call. I'll give you the numbers in a minute, but I'll ask you to give me a call here at the church, and we'll be glad. We never turn anybody away for counseling. And so hope that you'll give us a call there. Breakfast in the morning. The bus is going out every Sunday now, picking up groups of kids, which is wonderful. And we have breakfast this morning. I think they had French toast, right? French toast and eggs, and was it a good breakfast? Oh, yeah, it was a good breakfast, right, yeah. Somebody that's shy, just not shy anymore, because it was a good breakfast, right? So we had a great time. This week, because New Year's Eve is Thursday, we will not have our kids program this week, but we'll have it again next. We'll get back next week after school, because school will start before then, but we won't have Kid Fusion, and I think we're not having Bible study this week. We'll bring everything back together next week. If you want to get in touch with us, you can get in touch with me at Community Bible Church, Reverend Babcock, cbc.tville@yahoo.com. If you want to write me on the internet. Or you can write me by mail, P.O. Box 41, Titusville, 16354. And let's see if I can. Sometimes this doesn't work. There we go. And one of the ways, if you know somebody that I just passed on to somebody at Kent State this week. Our www.oilregionlive.com address. So you go to oilregionlive.com and then go to religious services, and you can go to Community Bible Church. You can also see us on Facebook, and we get almost everything on Facebook, and a lot of photos and things that we don't get anyplace else, we get on Facebook. And we want to thank Armstrong Cable and the stream. And I was on, I don't know if anybody saw me this week, but I was on a stream. They very graciously invited me to come talk about Christmas. We had a wonderful time, and I thought it was a good program. And then again, I'd say if you want to get in touch with me, you can call us here at the church, 814-967-3628, 814-967-3628. I must tell you, when it comes to praises and prayer requests, I truly was a blessing to be here Christmas Eve, and it's truly a blessing this morning to be here and see so many kids coming here and being here and doing their chores, earning their stars. The kids all earn stars so they can cash those stars in at the bookstore here, and so. We have a great group of kids, and it's good to see all of you here. So that's my praise, is that that God has just worked out wonderful miracles, and we've had so many wonderful kids here. Anyone else have a praise that they want to share with us? Yes, Linda.
I want to praise the Lord that the Lord watched over my sister and her family through those tornadoes. They live in Tennessee. And I
want to
thank you for taking care of them.
Okay. For your sister who was in Tennessee through the storms, right? And we'll have to add those people to our list as well. Yes, Abby, you have a praise?
We all get better.
Uh-huh. Yeah, we're going to pray that everybody gets over their cold, that it went... That's been making the rounds, and everybody's just got a little bit of flu. Anyone else this morning? Jean.
I'd like to thank God for all that snow that we didn't get.
Yeah. We all the snow that we haven't gotten, and I tell you, if it wasn't raining, I was going to be concerned that I might have to be mowing grass for New Year's instead of. I got a smile there, right? So, yes. Anyone else this morning? Praise or prayer request? We Sarah's out, and we'll keep her in. Sarah, in prayer. Sue must be out sick, And Rick and Sue. And I know Rick has been having trouble with the flu. Anyone else this morning? Prayer request. All the kids go back to school. Not this week, though, right? You're all off this week. Oh, my goodness. We have to pray for moms, right? We have to pray for moms. You're going to drive moms crazy, right? All right. So we have to pray for moms this week because they have the kids all week. And we'll pray that the kids are good. Anyone else this morning have a praise, a prayer request? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all that you do for us. We thank you for our country, and we thank you for all of our children. We thank you for the wonderful time that we had here in celebrating the birthday of Jesus our Lord. We thank you for all of our families, and we thank you for their dedication to our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for our kids who come and participate and show such wonderful smiley faces and have such a wonderful time here. We ask you, Lord, to be with those at home. We know that there are those at home that have praises to lift up to you, and that you hear those praises as well. We know that there are those at home who have prayer requests, Lord, and we ask you to continue to watch over them. Lord, we have mixed blessings with the storm. We thank you for those that survived the storm, and Lord, we keep in prayer those that struggling in Texas and Mississippi and through the South, through the devastating tornadoes, and we just ask you to watch over them. We ask you to be with all of those that are homesick today with the flu, Rick and Sue, and we ask you to be with Sarah as she is away. We just ask you to continue to bless this church and to bless all that we do, to reaching out to all of the kids and people around to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask you to pray for this. We pray for this country. We ask you to keep your hand over this country, over our leaders, and over all that's going on. This is truly a difficult time, and we certainly need much guidance from you. Help us to be all that we can be. Be with our kids this week. Keep them happy and healthy and strong and able, and keep this flu bug away from all of those that are not sick. We ask you to give them a good week and give their moms and their dads a good week as well. And we ask all these things in the name of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Angels we have heard on high.
Oh,
I get a great joy out of being here and get to see the faces and of the kids and watch them as they sing. That's a hard song to sing, but we have kids singing that, and it's truly a joy to me to see all of you. Our scripture this morning is from 1 Timothy 2:1-8. 1 Timothy 2:1-8. If you have a Bible or a Bible in your seat or by your side, you can turn to with me. If you're at home, please turn with me to 1 Timothy 2:1-8. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved, and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time, whereunder I am ordained a preacher and an apostle. I speak the truth in Christ, and I lie not, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity, which is certainty. He teaches in the Gentiles in faith and certainty. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. With faith and certainty. Paul says that Christians are to pray for public officials. And I take it that he means that the prayers were to be made in the church. To bring this up to date, he is saying that the Democrats ought to pray for the Republicans, and the Republicans ought to pray for the Democrats. And the independents ought to pray for both, and vice versa. Many years ago, a famous chaplain of the Senate was asked by a visitor, "Do you pray for the senators?" And he replied, "No, I look at the senators and then I pray for the country." That is exactly what Paul says we need to do. We need to pray for our country, and we need to pray for those who have authority over us. For kings, Paul says we are to pray for the kings who rule. You may ask, yes, but are we to pray when the government is a corrupt one? Paul is saying we are to pray even if it's corrupt, even if it's a corrupt government. We are to pray for whoever is in power. Remember that the man who was in power in Rome at the time that Paul wrote was Nero. And Nero was very bloody. And he killed many Christians. Yet Paul says that we are to pray for kings, whoever they are. So you can't separate Paul's instruction from time and say, well, it's okay, because he probably was in the most corrupt and a difficult time with government, and still made that instruction. That we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. I agree with those who argue that politics is crooked. Man has certainly corrupted and misused political power, but there does remain a semblance of law and order. We have seen the chaos in the world lately when that government has been destabilized all around the Middle East. We have seen where we've gone in actually to try to make things better. Somehow we've seemed to have made things worse, I think, in many places. Civil government is a gift from God, and we ought to give thanks for it and pray for it. Especially here in the United States, when we have law and order, we have policemen, we have the rule of law, where we can go and we can come and we can be secured in our property. Not too many years ago, I was in Africa, in Nigeria, and one of the things that the government there was desperately trying to get people to do, and I was working for the Department of Defense. And one of the things that the government in Nigeria was trying to do, I was there for the first free election in the government of Nigeria, and we were trying to figure out how to feed all the people. The the British had left, and they had instituted the elections, and there was going to be an election, and we went out and flew around and went around the country and found out that Nigeria could be the breadbasket of all of Africa. It has wonderful, wonderful lands to farm. But because the government and the Biafra War and all of the things that happened at the time destabilized the people, it pushed everybody into the cities. Lagos became a huge city. All of the other Nigerian cities around became huge cities. And everybody left the farmland. They left the farmland because they couldn't be protected out on the farm. The government had no ability to protect the people. Here in this country, you can live on a farm, and you can develop that farm, and you can know that it's your property. But over in the countries around the world, it's not always that way. I was in Hungary when right directly after the collapse of communism, and the government of Hungary was having a terrible time feeding its people because they had huge farmlands, lots and lots of farmland all around Hungary. But during the time of communism, things weren't peaceful, and the government wasn't stable, and the people were driven off the farms. Matter of fact, there wasn't even any livestock at the time that I was there. There was all this land because the government had big corporate farms, and when that all collapsed, there wasn't anybody that was farming the land. The government had decided that one of the things that the new government that came in in Hungary decided that what they were going to do was they were going to get everybody that owned land prior to 60 years ago, they were going to give that land back to them. And so they sent out they hunted all over Budapest and around the country, and they found the farmers, and they would give these certificates to them to, you know, give them their land back. And when I was there, it was just curious. It was interesting because I was on my bicycle and I see so much farmland that wasn't being used, and discovered that, you know, the people had been living in the city all this time. They were afraid to go back to the farms. They'd have the certificate on their on their mirror in their living room. Said, "I don't know what to do out there. We've been here, you know, for the last 60 years. We're not farmers anymore." So the government that we have here protects us. And around the world, we don't often realize that the stability that we have allows us to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. So civil government is a gift from God, and we ought to give thanks for it and pray for it. Many of us fall short of praying for our government in order that we might continue to live quietly and peaceably. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. A second reason we should pray for government is in order that the gospel might continue to go out to the lost. I believe that we are today actually seeing the persecution of Christians in this country. It's interesting for me to go back through my commentators and writing and see that many Bible commentators that I was looking at said that they thought that in the future that there would be persecution in this country of Christians, that at some time in the future that we would see that. But the future actually is here, and we're seeing persecution of Christians already in this country. Paul was beginning to experience persecution himself, and he said the believers were to pray for the leaders who were responsible for it. It was good and acceptable in the sight of God to pray for these men. Why? Because it is God's will that all men might be saved. I want to meet a man in the office of government who is going to make it possible for the word of God to continue to be given to the lost. This should be our concern and our prayer. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. The Romans worshiped many gods, and today people worship many gods in a different sort of way. People are giving themselves to many things, some to pleasures, some to entertainment, and so on. The entertainment world and the sports world, for example, has become a religion of sorts for many people all over this planet, nearly every place you look. People have many different gods today, but there is only one God, and He is the creator of all things. He created you and me, and all we see and smell and touch and taste and hear around us. One God created us, each one of us. A lot of people want to ignore that and want to live their lives as if we are descended from a long line of mistakes. You are not a mistake. You are loved, and you were planned for. God created all this around you just for you. He sent His Son to be a baby and to live on this earth and to suffer for each one of you. He was treated very badly by the people in power, by the government. They beat Him and tortured Him and finally put Him to death. Yet He tells Paul to teach all of us to pray for our leaders and our government. It is hard to make big changes in our lives. Coming to salvation is a big change for most of us. We must first understand that we are missing something. Our lives are empty and they are not going in any good direction. When we come to understand that we must repent, that means to turn completely around. That is hard. It means that we come to recognize that the life we are living is taking us to nowhere that is good, either for us or anyone around us. When we get to that point, we can finally be honest with ourselves and know that we are sinners. That means we have committed acts of things like lying or stealing or cheating or many other things we would not do if we were standing right next to God and Jesus. We know we wouldn't do those things because we know instinctively that God and Jesus loves us and they only want to do good for us. Paul tells us there is only one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. Jesus came to earth as a baby to bring us life. He actually came to bring us a better life. The Bible tells us that the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. Jesus says, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. The thief comes into your house only to steal from you, to take something away, to leave you with less. But Jesus comes to bring you more. He comes to bring you life. You might say, I am breathing, I already have life. But the life Jesus is bringing is life forever and ever in heaven. We are all born with life forever. Each of us will live forever and ever. But it is where you live forever and ever that is important and why Jesus came. We each have a choice to make about where we want to live that forever and ever. Jesus came to bring us life that has great joy and great abundance. If we want to live where forever and ever will be full of joy and wonderful things, we have to follow Jesus, and that is why Jesus came, and that is what He is talking about when He said He came to bring us life more abundantly. We are not good enough to stand before God all on our own. We need a mediator. We are not good enough because we have sin that stands between us and God. Jesus came so that all who say they love Jesus and accept Him as Lord and Savior can have their sins covered, removed, forgiven. That means that we must first know we need Jesus and know that we are not perfect. We need Jesus to help us get to heaven. The devil, Satan, is the thief who comes into your life to steal from you. Oh, I know. In these days, there are lots of things that seem fun. Drugs, alcohol, sex, stealing from someone else. There are a lot of them. The devil makes them seem fun because when you do those things, he is actually and really stealing your life away from you. Job's heart cry Job back in the Old Testament. You know, the story of Job where God told Satan that he could try and test Job but not take his life. Job has this struggle because Satan does all kinds of things to him and he won't turn away from God. But Job's heart cry through all of this, even in his day, was, "Neither is there any daysman between us that might lay his hand upon us both." In effect, Job was crying out, "Oh, if there was somebody who could take hold of God's hand and then take hold of my hand and bring us together, that there might be communication and understanding between us." He wanted somebody to be there, to be able to hold his hand, who was holding God's hands, who was the mediator between. And that's what Job was crying for. Today, we do have a mediator. In Job's time, there was no mediator between God and man. But today the Lord Jesus Christ has come on purpose. He came here willingly to be your mediator. He has one hand in the hand of deity, or the one hand in the hand of God, because he is God. He is able to save to the uttermost because he is God. And he has paid the price for our salvation. That's a funny thing for many people to understand, and I think that it's hard for us to understand that we need to be saved, that we're sinners and we need to be saved. Once we become saved and we get in church and we understand more, we recognize and we understand how much we needed to be saved. It's a difficult situation because the scales have to fall off our eyes in order for us to see. We have to come to a point where our lives aren't the most wonderful, and we realize that we need a Savior, that we need somebody standing between us and God, that we aren't going in the right direction, and we aren't going to make it to the place that we want to go. And so we have to take that on faith, that we need a Savior, and that Jesus Christ is the Savior that stands between us and God. He is a mediator because he has also become man. He understands all of us. He can hold my hand because he understands me. He understands you, and you can go to him, and he is not going to be upset or mad with you. He will not lose his temper or strike you or hurt you in any way. You may say, "Well, I failed. I've done terrible things. I've done such and such. And I've come short of the glory of God." And you have to understand that we have all been there. Even Paul, who's writing this scripture. We've all fallen short. Not one of us are perfect. None of us are capable of making it to heaven on our own. I'm kind of, thank God that we're not capable of making it. Some of us are capable of making it to heaven on our own. It would be a tough situation. I know that in the New Age religion, they want to say that, well, just being a good neighbor, being a good person. I know Sasha and I, as he came back from the university, had a discussion about good people yesterday at the dinner table before he went back to Kent State. And they had to tell him, you know, that as good a person as you can be, you can't be good enough to get to heaven. Now, he knows that because he's born again, but yet at where he's at the university, he's mixed with other cultures. And part of what, you know, that they want to tell is that if you're just good enough, just that's what's important. You know, to be a good person, work to be a good person. And I have to tell him, you know, that being a good person isn't good enough. You can be a good person all you want, but being a good person won't get you to heaven. The only thing that will get you to heaven is accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he can accept us because he knows us. He was here on earth. He came. We celebrated his birthday as Christmas. He came to be a man. He knows that. He still loves you and he wants to put his arms around you. He is a daysman. a mediator. He has put his hand in mine. I don't put my hand in his, but he reaches out and he puts his hand in mine. He says, I stand at the door and knock. He knocks and waits for us. That is the wonder of it all. He has come down and put his hand in mine and taken hold of me. But he also holds on to God because he is God. And he has brought us together. This mediator is the one who the world needs to know, because there is but one way to salvation. Peter says to the religious leaders in his day, neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Jesus Christ is the only way. But the tremendous thing is that he will bring you right through to God if you will turn to him. One time while I was in Canada, I was told that I needed to go to a certain freeway to get to Detroit, Michigan. But if I missed that freeway, I was in real trouble. I would be going in the wrong direction, and it would take me miles and miles and miles out of the way before I could turn around and go back and try to find the intersection. It took a great deal of manipulating around, but once I managed to find that freeway, that one freeway ramp that you get onto, it brought me right into Detroit. I was thankful for the man who said, there is only one way. I'm also thankful that I have been told there is only one way to God, one mediator. He is the only one who can bring us together. He can bring us to God because he is God and he is also a man, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Ransom is anti-lutron in the Greek, and it means a redemption price. Christ paid a price for our redemption. It cost money to redeem you. It cost something, not money, but it cost something to redeem you. And Christ paid that price to redeem you. He took our sin on him, and he paid that price for you. Because we need a redeemer, and he's the only one that could do that. So he came here purely out of love for you to be the redeemer, to pay that price. He knew that there was going to be a tremendous price before he came. Yet he came anyway to pay that price so that you could be redeemed. And we need a redeemer. You and I were, and some are, lost sinners. And he is and was the ransom. Paul says, I am ordained. Might be better translated, I am appointed. Paul says that he was appointed a preacher and an apostle. Preacher comes from the Greek word kerygmos, which means a herald or a trumpet, referring to one who gives out the gospel. He has been appointed one to declare the gospel. He stands way back when he started, way back when he was blinded on the road to Damascus. God appointed him then, and the truth that he taught continues right to this day, and it must continue without change, because there is only one truth. It was something else that Sasha and I were discussing yesterday with ethics. And I kept telling him, there is only one truth. There is only one truth. There's only one ethic. Everything else is situation ethics. There is one ethic. It comes from the Bible. And there is one truth. That one truth is that we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What's our memory verse? All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. That comes from Isaiah, way back in the Old Testament. That we all fall short of the glory of God. And God May Jesus be the price. Because there is only one truth. There is only one way. There's just like going into Detroit. There's lots of freeways all around. But there's only one way that gets you across the bridge. He was appointed by God to speak that truth, as we're talking about Paul. But Paul was appointed by God to speak that truth back then. And I'm appointed by God to speak that truth to you today. And we both say to you, I speak the truth in Christ and lie not. Why do we do that? Why is that important? Because we want everybody to come to salvation. We want everybody to be raptured up in the clouds when we come to meet our Lord. We want everybody to be there. It's tough for a pastor who hears people say, well, you guys just want to be better than everybody else. But we want everybody else to be part of what we are. We want everybody to be in heaven. We don't want to leave anybody out. Some people say, I'm not good enough because I've done bad things. But even the preacher comes and says, there's nothing that you've done that's so bad. Paul did terrible things too. Paul was a murderer. He went after all of those who followed Jesus Christ. And it took God blinding him on the road to Damascus to bring him to his knees and to bring him to salvation. And Paul says to you, after being the person that says that all this stuff was garbage, all this stuff about Christianity wasn't the truth. Paul, who said that was out there persecuting the Christians and trying to chase them down, it was Paul who finally comes around and says that I'm preaching Christ to the Gentiles. I'm preaching because God gave me the message and I know it's the truth and I lie not. And while he's standing there chained to the Praetorian Guard, and Nero as the emperor killing many people, Paul is telling us to pray for them. Because Paul even wanted Nero to be in heaven. Because hell is going to be so bad, it's not going to be a place that anyone wants to be in. Paul wants us all to be there. Satan comes to steal from you and to lie. And he tells you that you can't be and this is all garbage and a bunch of baloney. But truly, this message goes all the way back to Paul and it hasn't changed. We are all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. And we all can be redeemed because we have a Savior. Jesus the Christ, the only way, the only truth. My hymn of dedication this morning is, I want to walk as a child of the light. We had a wonderful lighting ceremony, Christmas Eve, makes me think of this song. I want to walk.
Jesus,
If anything I've said this morning touches your heart, you are wrestling with the idea of salvation and wanting to know more, please give me a call or come by and see me. You can call me at one of the numbers that I gave you earlier. You can always come by and see me when I'm here. We want everyone to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That would be the best New Year's gift that anyone could give themselves, the best Christmas gift, and the best thing that anyone could start their New Year's upon. Will our usher please come forward? Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you do for us, all that you give us. We thank you for your Son who's loved us so much that he followed your instruction to the cross. All that we have because of you. And we put a portion of that back into your storehouse so that we could spread the gospel of Jesus Christ around this community and as far as we can go. I thank you for each and every offering. And I thank you also for each and every offering from each and every person who not only gives money but gives time and talent. For certainly, Lord, we have those who give so much to this church. I thank you for each of our children who come and participate and are part of and are part of spreading this gospel to their friends as well. We ask you to be with each of our children. Watch over them as they go this week, to be with their mothers and their fathers, and we ask you to keep them all healthy and strong and happy. Bring them back to us next Sunday. We ask you to give us each the opportunity to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to someone, to tell someone just like the children are not afraid to do. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. We all know that. You love us so much. Help us to spread that news around to all the world. Watch over us and guide us. Be it for our homes and our cars and our jobs and our comings and goings and all that we do. Bring us your peace and your love and your protection for this new year. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful, wonderful week, a wonderful new year, and you may all be dismissed. Thank you.